Good morning, friends. Welcome to this CEC Edisset live lecture, dear friends, with another lecture on in this series on history of English literature. Today we would be talking on the School of Dynal Thomas. In the first session we would be discussing on the spirit of surrealism, whereas in the second half we would be discussing on Thomas and his contemporaries. And for this very discussion we have once again with us in our studios Professor Bhimsen Dahiya. Professor Bhimsen Dahiya is a retired professor, and as well as he is a formerly vice chancellor of Kurukshetra University. So dear friends, let's take advantages from his experiences and let's welcome our guest Professor Bhimsen Dahiya, and let's try to understand more and more on the topic, the School of Dylan Thomas. Hello sir, welcome to the Edisset lecture.
Thank you. Well, we will discuss in this lecture the School of Dylan Thomas and the movement with which he was associated. Surrealism was the phenomenon of the 1940s, which falls between 1920s and 1930s. 1920s we call the age of modernism. 1930s we call the age of Marxism, and post-war, the 1950s, we call the movement poetry. That way, with every decade we associate movements as well as poets. Not that movements and poets are born according to the decades, but then for our convenience, for clarifying things, and clarification would always include simplification. So we simplify things, straighten them, put them in some order. That is why we speak of decades, we speak of movements, and then associate these poets with decades and movements. So 1940s, the decade with which Dylan Thomas was associated. This was known for the movement of surrealism. Now, what is surrealism? You can look at it from both ends. You can look at it from the romanticism. You can also look at it from realism. These are two poles, two ends, romanticism and realism. Now, this Dylan Thomas, his movement, or the movement with which he was associated, surrealism, falls in between the 1930s and 1950s. As for Dylan Thomas, he was born in 1914, which was the beginning of World War I, and died in 1953, after the World War II was over, which ended in 1945. In a way, the life of Dylan Thomas scans or covers the most turbulent period in modern history. two world wars, first beginning 1914, ending 1918. That's when Dylan was a child, born in 1914. When the war ended, he was just 5 years. Then came World War II, 1939. And ended 1945. By that time, Dylan was grown up, mature, had accomplished most part of his poetic achievement, and he died in 1953. So these two world wars, each running through 5-6 years, put together, they constitute the most turbulent part, as I said, of modern world history, because they were world wars, not confined to a country or two, but spread all over the globe in a way. It was during this period that Dylan Thomas grew up and wrote his poetry, which was defined as surrealism. Now, surrealism, as I said, can be defined both from the one end, romanticism, and the other end, realism. If you relate it to romanticism, then surrealism is a concentrated form of romanticism. Means more romantic than the romantic. And the subject matter of surrealism is emotionalism, nightmare, and such other disturbing moments of your life. So obviously, it's not normal life which realism depicts. Romanticism is emotional, imaginative. Realism is drab, dull, everyday sort of life. That is covered by realism. Romanticism, unusual, abnormal. Whereas realism, normal, everyday, day-to-day life. So two opposites, two extremes. And surrealism is in between in a way. It shares the abnormality of romanticism, but it also shares things that happen in real life, realism. So that is how we define surrealism, and it is associated with the 1940s. As I said, for our convenience, we draw these lines horizontally as well as vertically. Movement-wise, as well as poet-wise. So we call Dylan Thomas the poet of the 40s, whereas the fact is that his first volume of poems, 18 poems, that came out in 1934, which was not 40s, it was 30s. And yet, he is called the poet of the 40s. And servilism also is located in the 1940s. So that we do for our convenience, for simplifying, for clarifying. Because without clarification, no knowledge is possible. You understand things only by making a sort of arithmetic of it. So you group things, you divide things, you put them together, then you generalize about them, so on and so forth. So all these factors add up to simplification of difficult subjects and clarification of the ticklish points of history, of knowledge. So that is how Dylan Thomas has to be approached. And we have to begin with surrealism, as I said, because that was the dominant movement of the 1940s. And he's called the poet of the 40s, although his first volume, as I said, came out in 1934. And it was just titled 18 Poems. He himself was Anglo-Welsh, means a combination or a mixture of England and Wales, you know, UK, United Kingdom, consists of England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. These four countries or four states constitute, put together, UK. So Dylan Thomas half belonged to England and half belonged to Wales. So that's why he's called Anglo-Welsh poet. And obviously every nation has its own socio-political life, cultural life, its own civilization. So obviously there is no uniformity throughout UK. They have their individual identities. Scotland has its own. They still keep fighting for more independence, although now they are a separate country after 1707, when they had their separate parliament, separate from the British. The movement for freedom has been intensifying, and they have been getting more and more. Now they have, in a way, separate statehood, and yet part of UK. So it is a unique sort of combination. You are an independent state and yet you are not an independent state. You are Scotland and yet you are a part of UK where England dominates. Same with Ireland, same with Wales. So Dylan Thomas wrote between 1914 and 1953 several volumes of poetry. He was very productive. And the first, as I said, was 18 poems, which came out in 1934. One of his best known poems in this volume was The Force That Through the Green Fuse Drives the Flower. The force that through the green fuse drives the flower. Now look at the mixing of images, vocabulary, diction. In this title itself, there is a mix of the natural and the scientific. Think of the word force. Force comes from the scientific calendar, that register. But then flower comes from the natural. So the two get mixed up, combined. The force that through the green fuse, now again, green and fuse. Fuse falls in the scientific register. Green falls in the natural. So both the natural and the scientific, or the civilizational, or the cultural, they are combined. And it is not haphazard. It is not out of whim that he is doing it. It is a well thought out, well drafted title. And he is trying to show that the human machine is both natural as well as scientific. The biology, the organism that functions is very much on scientific principles. At the same time, we have imbibed and we are born with natural tendencies, our emotions, our feelings, our imagination itself. These are natural aspects of our personality, of our character. So just as civilization proceeds with the interaction of these two opposites, nature and science, or nature and civilization, or nature and culture. Similarly, man's own development is through the interaction of these two, nature and civilization or culture or human mind. So, interaction of the mind and the surroundings, the cosmos, nature. William Blake in the 18th century and early 19th, had said a very prophetic and a very true statement about life and nature. He said, without contraries, there is no progression. And that was a sort of motto for his first volume of poems, Songs of Innocence and Songs of Experience. These two are also opposites, innocence and experience. But then both must coordinate and combine to go further, to develop, to grow. That is how human life and man's own personality are constituted and developed. So very thoughtfully and very carefully, Dylan Thomas is combining in the title of this poem, nature and civilization. nature and science. The very words speak of that. Look at the following lines, for example, from that very poem. And I am dumb to tell the lover's tomb. And I am dumb to tell the lover's tomb how at my seat goes the same crooked worm. Now imagine, the two lines are totally disconnected in a way, and yet they are vitally linked. The first line, and I am dumb to tell the lover's tomb. Somebody standing at the tomb of lovers, say Romeo and Juliet, or Sini Farhad, or Jahangir and so, or Taj Mahal, Shah Jahan and Noor Jahan. So somebody is standing there at the lover's tomb and he says, I am dumb to tell the lover's tomb. I can't speak out. I'm tongue-tied, as Shakespeare says. I don't know what to say. I'm standing at the lover's tomb. The implied meaning is, I don't know whether their love was to any use, whether it make any sense, or it didn't. It was just out of half. So he's making us think about it. Think about the very act of loving, without which human life seems meaningless. And love is the most vital part of our life. It may be love between opposite sexes. It may be humanly love, brotherly love, love for mankind. So various forms of love, various stages of love, various types of love. But it is central to our life, to our growth. So Blake comes to mind, without contraries, opposites, there is no progression. And that was proved later by the law of physics, which is called the law of friction. So when two things rub each other, one goes forth through rubbing. So the movement forward becomes possible only by this rubbing. There is resistance from the below and there is force from above. You are trying to go forth, but something below that is pulling you back. So out of that friction, movement is created and progress takes place. So that is the law of nature, and that's the law of civilization. History tells us human civilization has also progressed through these opposites and through the conflicts of the opposites. Even the internal conflict between mind and heart. Your heart comes out with all sorts of emotions, feelings, and mind with all sorts of imaginations. Sometimes the coordination between the two is not possible. Sometimes there is a direct clash between the two agencies of your organism. But then, out of that very clash, that very conflict, the movement forward will be determined, will come out. So it is essential. So it may be the individual, or it may be the cosmos. Both the micro level as well as the macro level, both are constituted of the opposites, the contraries. Without the conflict between them, progress is not possible. So this is precisely what Dylan Thomas is doing in his poetry. He is showing the conflict and yet the attempt at reconciliation of the opposites. Because unless there is harmony between nature and civilization, disasters will keep taking place. Disasters have been taking place. It may be these two world wars, which have been recent, just in the last century. And maybe the natural disasters of earthquake or whatever, even the cloud burst counts for the killing of so many people. But then these are the opposites which constitute the individual life as well as cosmic life. And without a conflict between them, between the opposites, no progression is possible. So, thank you for the time being. Thank you. Well, to resume the story of Dylan Thomas and his contemporaries, or the story of the 1940s, we were talking about the opposites. How, just like Blake, Dylan Thomas and his contemporaries also rely upon the dialectic of the opposites. How the opposites conflict, come into clash, and yet there is an attempt at resolution, at reconciliation. That's how human civilization has progressed. That's how culture has come up as a sort of cream of civilization. And Dylan Thomas, very subtly, is showing that very drama, natural drama, of conflict both within the human personality as well as outside on the cosmic level. Both. I read out those two lines and a few more lines. This is from another poem. This time the poem is Light Breaks Where No Sun Shines. Look at it. It's very puzzling. It's very confusing. Light breaks means light comes out where no sun shines. It's an unusual, abnormal kind of situation, phenomenon, because light comes only when sun rises. You can't have light in the absence of the sun. But then, the poem's title is that light breaks where no sun shines. Unheard of, and yet the poets have the liberty to imagine such things, the impossibilities, the improbabilities, the unusual, the uncommon. And that is what we have here. Now, let's see what he says in this poem. I read out just a few lines, opening lines. Light breaks on secret lots. Light breaks on secret lots, on time of thought, where thoughts smell in the rain. When logics die, the secret of the soil grows through the eye, and blood jumps in the sun. Above the waste allotments, the dawn halts. Look at both vocabulary and the style, manner. Both style and diction are very unusual, very unconventional, untraditional, unfamiliar. If you go back to the very beginning of history of English literature, say with Chaucer, right up to this 20th century, we do not have this kind of language which Dylan Thomas is using. Deliberately mixing, as I said, nature and civilization, science and nature, and at the same time using the syntax, which again is not traditional, not common, not according to the established grammar or prosody. It's a very unusual sort of, you see, coinages. Look at it. Light breaks on secret lots. Secret lots are in dark places. How can light break on dark places? But then the poet has the liberty, as I said, to imagine things, to imagine impossibilities. And there are dark corners in the mind, and thoughts have the freedom to enter any territory, even these dark spots, secret lots, secret places. So that is what he is talking about. Light breaks on secret lots. These secret lots are of the mind. So light travels, thought travels, mind moves into those dark regions also, and then throws light on them, shows you those dark patches, spots in our own constitution and in the constitution of the universe, cosmos. So light breaks on secret lots, on time of thought where thoughts smell in the rain. Now look at the construction. Thoughts smell in the rain. Have you ever heard of? Do thoughts smell? Thoughts are thoughts, abstract. They don't have any body, any material existence. You can't say they are green or red, or their smell is foul, or it is fragrant. You can't say all that, because thoughts have nothing of these, and yet Dylan Thomas, as a poet, has the liberty to attribute these very traits to thoughts. So, on time of thought where thoughts smell in the rain, smell in the rain. So, that is how natural, you see, phenomenon of raining and the enlightening of the mind, throwing light on the dark patches, dark spots, mysterious aspects of life and human nature. So, in Dylan Thomas, you must have noticed by now, there is a combination of pantheism and mysticism. Just as in Wordsworth, rather than the formal religion of Christianity, he more believed in the religion of nature, and believed in the natural phenomena, maybe sun, moon, night, day, and so on. So believing in that rather than the man-made arithmetic of any religion, whatever. So he is doing, Dylan Thomas, very subtly, combining nature with science, man-made thoughts, philosophies, and he is blending the natural and the unnatural, the man-made and God-made. The two things are being blended into one. And how the opposites come into conflict and yet attempt an internal coordination or interaction or reconciliation, finally. All this comes out in the poem. Light breaks on secret lots, on time of thought where thoughts smell in the rain. When logics die, of course, man and his mind, they have their limitations. Man has been engaged in comprehending the mysteries of life. Where did the sun and moon come from? Who created this earth? Why do trees grow on the earth? How come that more than 3/4 part of earth is covered by water? And yet, earth is going round the sun with all that water, ocean, sea, and all other things. These are mysteries of life. And humans have been engaged in trying to understand, comprehend, resolve these mysteries. Who made all this? How do they operate? We have been able to understand parts of it, but not the entire thing. To begin with, we used to think that it is the sun that goes round the earth, because we always see the sunrise. We still say the sunrise. Look at the limitation of language and our comprehension. Even though we know today that sun is stable, it is fixed, it is not moving, it is not rising or falling, it is the earth which is going round the sun. And yet, our language will say the sun rises in the east, sun sets in the west. It neither rises nor sets, but that is how we see it. We see it coming up and we see it going down, morning, evening. But science, right in the 17th century, in fact in the 15th, Galileo, Copernicus, and later scientists, they had proved by very mathematical logics that it's not the sun that moves, it's the earth that moves, other planets that move. Sun is the only fixed one. Others go round and round the sun. And yet, as I said, our language continues to be the same. It has not changed. Because our language we create by what we see. We see the sun in the morning, we see the sun in the evening. So we call it the same way. Our language functions as we see things. Language is nothing but a description of what we see, what we do, what we hear, so on and so forth. So that's how it goes. Light breaks on secret lots, on time of thought where thoughts smell in the rain. When logics die, because ultimately logics prove that there are mysteries of life which are beyond the comprehension of logics. Man has created n number of logics, philosophies, sciences, and yet man cannot claim to have discovered the entire truth about life and universe. So when logics die, the secret of the soil grows through the eye. He says, when all these human logics fail, then your eye opens to reality. Then you see what the secrets of nature are. In other words, what the poet is trying to say is that human creations of philosophies and sciences have their limitations because they are creations of the human mind. But this universe was not created by a human mind. Human mind is only a part of the cosmic existence which is constituted of billions of things. Human mind is just one. Hence, Dylan Thomas's statement, when logics die, because logics cannot solve everything, the mysteries of life, of nature, will still remain beyond the comprehension of man's mind, human mind. The secret of the soil grows through the eye. When? When your logics fail and blood jumps in the sun. Imagine. Look at the expression. The blood jumps in the sun. Above the waste allotments, the dawn halts. The dawn halts where? Above the waste allotments. So it reflects the turbulence of the times. The two world wars, as I said, one had ended, the other was just about to begin. 1934, that's when this volume of poems by Dylan Thomas, the first one, 18 poems, came out. So he is speaking at that critical point, juncture of time, when one world war has ended, the other is about to begin. So obviously it is in the air. And all that tension, all that turbulence, that gets reflected not only in the thought the poem contains, but also in the language, the diction, the style, how they are constituted of the opposites and the conflict and clash of opposites and yet attempt at reconciliation. reconciling the opposites, bringing us back to William Blake, without contraries, there is no progress. So the opposites are essential to progression. Without them, human civilization will not progress. Physics has proved that. The law of friction. Movement is possible only because there is friction between the two things, the wheel and the road or the surface. You want to go further, something is holding you back. But then you have to go. So friction, and friction will make the movement possible. So Blake had said it long ago, 18th century. Without contraries, there is no progress. Hence, we discover in our own human nature, in the human universe, the entire cosmos, and we find that there are contraries. There are opposites. If you think of one thing, there is another. There is day, there is night. There is morning, there is evening. There are bright thoughts and there are dark thoughts. There are smiles and laughters, and there are weepings and shedding tears. That's how life is made of. And Dylan Thomas is doing nothing but picturing all this and relating it to the times. Well, times are critical, crucial. He is standing at the threshold of another war. One is ended, the other is about to begin. It is very much in the air. The clouds are hovering. And it began in 1939 with Hitler taking over Poland just in a day, marching through it. So the poets have this extra perception. It is not just the five senses that we have through which the poet or human mind gathers knowledge or even creates knowledge. There is something extra, extrasensory. Imagination is one such thing, fancy and imagination. See, they give you the leap beyond the senses. And you then explore, you go into the darker regions, the mysteries of life and human nature, and you come out with all sorts of things. Then you try to sample them, simplify them, put them together, separate them, classify them, generalize them, and then discover some part of knowledge. All this goes on and has been going on and will go on for all times to come. And yet, what Dylan Thomas is trying to emphasize is mysteries will remain. You cannot reach the bottom of the mystery of this universe. Can you really say who created the universe? Scientists would say it was just an accident. Well, out of accident, the whole universe was created, and we are living in it, going forth. So great truth, and we cannot forget William Blake, and we link it up with Dylan Thomas and his times and his contemporaries, that without contraries, there is no progression. Thank you. Oh, jaldi to nahi karti aap? Nahi. It's time.
Dear friends, with this note, we would like to thank Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya for giving us a very, very vivacious session. And we would like to tell you all that if you want to give your feedback for this particular lecture, then you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. Dear friends, all the lectures concerning to this series, History of English Literature, are there for you on the YouTube. If you want to access those lectures, definitely you can go through the lectures, and this lecture is also going to be uploaded on YouTube for you. And after watching the lectures, if you feel so that there are some questions raised within your mind, within your heart, so feel free to talk to us, feel free to ask questions. For giving your feedback in terms of suggestions and questions, you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. So dear friends, we would be meeting again very soon and would be discussing on another topic. Till then, take care, goodbye, and yes, keep watching us and keep writing to us. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.